It's important to know how to estimate the net positive suction head available in the system so that you can prevent your pump from cavitating. Reducing the risk of cavitation will ensure the life of your pump, which is often a considerable investment. We start off with a reservoir that supplies water to our pump. The water exits the reservoir through a rounded entrance, passes through a 90-degree bend, and then heads into our pump. The pump, after doing its job, discharges the water into another tank higher up in elevation. The reservoir on the suction side of the pump is at an elevation of 1,150 feet. The pump inlet is at an elevation of 1,140 feet. And the reservoir on the discharge side of the pump is at an elevation of 1,380 feet. The length of the discharge pipe is 6,200 foot, 30-inch diameter pipe with a friction factor of 0.020. For the suction pipe, the length is 40 feet, the diameter is 12 inches, and the friction factor is 0.025. Our target flow rate for the system is 4,000 gallons per minute, and the fluid temperature is at 70 degrees Fahrenheit. The first mistake students typically make on this problem is considering the entire system shown on this page. The net positive suction head available is computed at the suction flange of the pump and only considers the piping system and reservoir on the suction side of the pump, this area right here. You can ignore the discharge pipe length, diameter, friction factor, and the elevation of the discharge reservoir. They are not relevant in this calculation. To make later computations easier, I like to calculate the area of the pipe first and then the velocity of the water in the pipe. For the pipe area, a 12-inch diameter pipe is 0.785 square feet. The velocity is found by converting the 4,000 GPM into cubic feet per second, so I divide by 448.8, then divide that by the area of the pipe, and I get 11.4 feet per second. The formula to compute net positive suction head available is the atmospheric pressure plus the elevation difference between the reservoir and the pump, minus the friction head, minus the minor losses, and minus the vapor pressure head. Each of these terms are a quick lookup or need to be calculated. So let's tackle each from left to right. There are many resources that provide information about the atmospheric pressure at different elevations. This table shown in this video comes from Pumping Station Design 3rd Edition. The appropriate atmospheric pressure for our example is measured at the suction flange of the pump. In this case, we want to know the atmospheric pressure at 1,140 feet above sea level. This means we need to interpolate between the values of 14.2 psi and 13.7 psi because our elevation is between 1,000 and 2,000 feet. We start with 14.2 minus 0.14 because we are 140 feet or 14% of the distance between 1,000 and 2,000 feet. Then we times that by 14.2 minus 13.7. The result is 14.1 pounds per inch squared. This result is in pressure, but I want it to be in pressure head or units of feet to make the final step easier. Therefore, I need to convert this value into feet. To do that, I multiply this number by 144 divided by the unit weight of water, gamma, at 70 degrees Fahrenheit. This means I have to go look up that value from my water properties table. And this is another key mistake students often make, is that they simply use 62.4 pounds per cubic foot for the unit weight of water, rather than accounting for the temperature of the fluid. The unit weight of water at 70 degrees Fahrenheit is 62.3 pounds per cubic foot. So the atmospheric pressure head has 32.6 feet. The next step is to calculate the static head of the fluid acting on the suction flange of the pump. This is just a fancy way of saying find the difference between the reservoir elevation and the pump elevation, which is 10 feet. The next calculation is to find the friction losses in the pipeline leading from the suction reservoir to the suction flange of the pump. In the problem statement, I gave you the friction factor so you know to use the Darcy-Weisbach equation. This equation is the friction factor times pipe length times velocity squared divided by the diameter of the pipeline times 2g. Plugging in our values, we get 0.025 times 40 feet times 11.4 feet per second squared divided by 1.5 feet times 64.4. We hit the enter button on our calculator and get a result of 2.0 feet. The next step is to calculate the minor losses, which is also written with a summation sign in the front. The minor losses are computed by summing up all of the minor loss coefficients, or K values, and multiplying these values by the velocity head, V squared over 2G. For our simplified system, we have an entrance loss coefficient of 0.25 plus a 90 degree bend coefficient of 0.25 times 11.4 squared divided by 64.4. This gives us 1.5 feet. Now we look up the vapor pressure head, which I find as 0.36 pounds per square inch. Vapor pressure is the amount of pressure that the layer of vapor exerts on the surface of water. All standing water has a certain amount of vapor pressure acting on it. So for this computation, we need to pull out the impact from the vapor layer. Once again, we multiply by 144 and divide by the unit weight of water at 70 degrees to get a vapor pressure head of 0.84 feet. For the final step, we calculate the net positive suction head available by just adding and subtracting numbers we picked up along the way. 32.9 feet plus 10 feet minus 2 feet for friction losses, minus 1.5 feet for the minor losses, minus 0.84 feet for the vapor pressure head, which is 37.3 feet. Given that we typically use a 5-foot buffer between the net positive suction head available and the net positive suction head required, this result tells us we cannot select a pump whose net positive suction head required is greater than 32.3 feet, at least for potable water application. About 40% of my students try to keep pressure in pounds per square foot, then try to convert all of the numbers in the final step at the end. Most of those typically make a mistake in the conversion process because of the large amount of computations and then make a mess of their final answer. Just make sure that each of the terms are in units of length, in this case feet, before going into the final calculation. It will make your life so much easier. As a final note, unless you end up as a water resources engineer, you may never do this calculation again. However, for all engineers, you need to understand what drives the problem of cavitation. There are two general causes. The first is not enough net positive suction head available, and the second is too much net positive suction head required by the pump. If you know each of the terms in the net positive suction head available calculation, then you should easily be able to understand the impact of changing any one of those values while keeping the others constant. For example, if atmospheric pressure increases, what is the impact on net positive suction head available? It increases. If there is a design change to the system that increases the minor losses, then the net positive suction head available will decrease. Every engineer, no matter what your favorite kind of project is to work on, should understand this.